So return to the same cubicle. We're back with the same lighting circuit last time. And we did which test last time, John?
So last time we were doing the continuity of CPC test, and we did that using the long lead method to measure the R2 value of the CPC. But we're going to use a different method this time, guys.
Yeah, that's not the most common method of actually measuring the continuity of the CPC in, say, a lighting circuit. Yeah. So we're going to go on and do the combined continuity of CPC and polarity tests, which we didn't include last time. So we didn't include the polarity test last time. We're going to include it this time. This means we'll be able to achieve a figure that we'll record in our test paperwork as.
Yeah, we'll record that as R1 plus R2. R1 being the resistance of the line conductor, R2 being the resistance of the CPC.
We record that in ohms, goes in our test paperwork, and then we'll also be able to record the fact that we've done the polarity. And what do we put in the polarity box?
We simply put a tick to prove that polarity is correct.
So we'll bring the camera in close, we'll set up our Megger MFT, and we'll get ready for that test.
Okay then, guys, so before we carry out the test that we've just spoken about, we need to get the meter set up correctly. So what are we going to be thinking about doing here?
So we've got our Megger MFT, our multifunctional tester, and as we're measuring the continuity of the CPC, in this case we're doing R1 plus R2. Continuity means we're measuring the resistance of the conductor. So we're going to flick it round to the scale here for ohms, and we're going to need to remove the resistance offered up by the leads themselves and the crocodile clip. So if we link those two together with the crocodile clip.
So it's important at this stage to make sure that those clips are actually touching the metal probe at the end of the instrument there, the end of the lead. So we're reading 0.01 of an ohm, so that looks like it's already zeroed.
It is, it's already zeroed.
So should we give it a quick double check?
Yep, so you press the test button once, and you see we have a reading. Press the test button again, and we've actually got zero. So we've actually removed the resistance offered up by the leads and the link before starting the test.
So now when we carry out the test, whatever reading we get on the screen, we know is the actual reading of the conductors.
And of all the readings we get, which one will we record, Joe?
Well, of course, we'll record the highest value for this test.
Let's get on with the test. So we're at the consumer unit end now, Joe. What are we up to in here?
So what we're going to do now is we're going to set up the start of the circuit so that when we go out to the rest of the circuit to test our continuity of CPC, we're going to make sure that we can get a reading. So what we're going to do is we're going to take our line conductor and we're going to connect it to the CPC. Now in this style of consumer unit, the Crabtree Star Breaker, there's nowhere that I can actually clip onto the line connection in the circuit breaker. So what I've done is I've removed the line conductor from the circuit breaker, and I'm going to connect from there directly onto the earth bar. So by connecting directly onto the earth bar, we've now got a link between the line conductor and the CPC. Now, if this lighting circuit was installed in earth metallic conduit or something similar, we'd have to make sure that we disconnected the CPC from the earth bar in here so that we didn't get any parallel earth paths going on with our circuit. We'll cover that in much more detail in a later video, but at this stage, because there's no chance of parallel earth paths with this circuit, we can simply connect it straight onto the earth bar. So with that connection made, we're ready to start carrying out our tests.
And by linking the line conductor to the CPC, we get R1 being the line conductor and R2 being the CPC when we measure their continuity or resistance of those conductors.
Absolutely spot on.
So Joe, we're at one of the lighting points on the radial lighting circuit. And what are you going to carry out for me?
So what we're going to do first of all is we're going to carry out the continuity of CPC test. We're going to basically prove that we've got the CPC is continuous to this point in the circuit. Now at the minute you can see this is a plastic switch, so actually there's no requirement for this to be connected to the main earthing terminal. However, down the line it may well be that a homeowner or a less professional person than ourselves might come along and replace this with a metallic switch. So we want to make sure that we've got that CPC connected all the way through to the circuit to every switch. So all I'm going to do here is test from the CPC terminal to the line connection at the top of the switch there, and then just make a mental note of that reading. So I've got 0.19 of an ohm. So now I'm happy that I've got a continuity of CPC reading to this point in the circuit. So we can now move on and test our next point. So inside this light fitting, we're going to test between line and CPC, just like we did down at the switch. But what we've got to think about here is we've actually got two different kinds of line connection. So here we've got our permanent line connection. So those are all permanently live when we turn the circuit breaker onto this circuit. And in the back here, we've got the switching line connection. Now that's the one that we're gonna test on, because that will give us a slightly higher reading after the, because we're also measuring the resistance of the conductor all the way down to the switch and all the way back again. So we'll get a slightly higher reading, and we're looking for the highest value of R1 plus R2 on this circuit.
Also, by using the switching line, which other tests will be incorporated during the continuity one, Joe?
We'll also be incorporating polarity into our test, which is obviously an important requirement of the regulations.
The switch will be left in which position once you've completed the continuity of CPC and polarity at this lighting point?
Once the test has been completed, we will leave the switch in the on position, because that's going to massively help us with our insulation resistance testing later.
So what are we up to here?
So again, we're just going to do the same thing. We're proving that we've got a CPC connection up to this point. However, there's a couple of things to think about, as you say. So first of all, we want to make sure not just that we've got the CPC continuous to the earth terminal in the back of this fitting, but we want to make sure that the CPC is also actually connected physically to the metal bodywork of this light fitting. It's no point just making sure that we've got a CPC connection here if the outgoing connection to the metalwork is dodgy out of this side. At this point, we can also prove polarity, so we can start to bring in that second test in this combined test. So first of all, let's just check that we do have continuity of CPC to this point. So I'm going to connect from the CPC terminal onto the line terminal there, and if you pan down and look at the meter reading there, you can see we're getting greater than 99.9 ohms. So basically what that means is that we've got an incredibly high reading, because that's actually greater than 99.9 kilo ohms. So we've got a huge unacceptable reading for a CPC measurement. So all we've got to do is flick the switch. And once we've flicked the switch, as you can see now, we're getting a much better reading. We're getting 0.66 of an ohm. So that's what we're looking at there. So we're happy that we've proved polarity. We've got the line being switched by the switch rather than the neutral in this case. And what we can now do is just prove beyond a shadow of a doubt that we've actually got an earth connection to the metalwork of the light fitting by connecting onto the back box like that. And you can see there we're getting 0.64 of an ohm, 0.63. So again, we'll make a mental note of that value that we took before, 0.65. We compare it to our value that we got at the first switch, 0.18. And then we can just think about which one of those is now the higher one. Well, obviously it's 0.65, so that's the one we're going to keep in mind unless we get a higher reading. So let's move on and test the next light.
So Joe, we've tested our first lighting point. Any other considerations?
So what we've got to think about now is, having completed this first test for this light and this switch, we're going to leave this switch in the on position. Now the reason for that is that when we come back to do our insulation resistance test a little bit later down the line, we want to test every scrap of cable, every bit of insulation that is within this circuit. So by leaving this in the on position, not only will we check the insulation on the permanent side of this switch, we will also check the insulation on the switch line side of this switch.
And as it's a one-way switch, is it important that we leave it in a certain position for when we screw it back actually to the box?
We want to leave it in the on position.
So can you show us what that looks like then, Joe, please?
If the switch has been wired up correctly, that should be the on position for a one-way switch.
So I'm at the next lighting point in the circuit. I'm now using the crocodile clip to clip onto the earthing terminal where the CPCs are connected, and my probe is on the switching line terminal within the baton lamp holder itself. If you look at the instrument, we can see we have a reading of 2.25 ohms, indicating the switches in this circuit have been left in the on position. We need to prove polarity, so we need to turn on those switches and off those switches in turn. So I'm going to go round and now operate the three switches that control this lighting point. So we should see the instrument hopefully go off, come back on. Must look at the reading. The readings will change depending on the amount of strappers in circuit. So we've got a slightly different reading now, slightly lower. Go to the next switch. It's gone off. Back round again. And then to the final switch. However, I've left it on off position when it needs to be left on. So therefore, I must turn any of the switches in this case, a two-way and intermediate, to turn it back on. I need to remember the highest reading I got. The highest reading I got during the test sequence was 2.25 ohms must be left in the on position for the insulation resistance test that we're carrying out later on. So we're down at the switches. We've got three final switches to test for continuity of CPC. I'm going to probe into the earth terminal at the back of the box where the CPC is connected and onto a line connection. And we see we have a reading of 1.67 ohms. Go to the next switch. Again, the earthing terminal at the back into the intermediate switch. And I have a reading of 0.72. And then I'm on to the final two-way switch in this circuit. Probing on, and I have a reading of 1.83 ohms. So Joe, we've completed the continuity of CPC and combined it with the polarity test, do you agree?
Yep, absolutely, we've got that spot on now.
And of all the readings we got, which one we record?
We're going to record the highest reading. So for any test that you carry out, a good rule of thumb is you're always looking to record the worst case reading. And in this case, the worst case reading would be the highest reading.
And we're going to record that in the what box heading in our test paperwork?
That's going to go under the R1 plus R2 column.
R1 standing for?
The resistance of the line conductor, and R2 standing for?
Resistance of the CPC conductor.
Brilliant.
That leaves us another box that we also can complete at this stage, which is the polarity box.
We're going to
put the polarity box, Joe?
We're just going to put a tick in the polarity box. We don't need to record any value for that. We just put a tick to show that it's been done and verified.
So that's the continuity of CPC for this lighting circuit, including the polarity test completed.
Yep.
And as we've only got one circuit on this distribution board, we don't need to go on and do further continuity tests. Do you agree?
Yeah, absolutely. We're quite happy with this circuit on that front now.
So it just leaves us to go on to the next test in the test sequence before this will be?
Insulation resistance.
So we're going to do the insulation resistance test next. So we're going to hit the covers on. We're going to do that in another video presentation.
Yep.
We're also going to look at the possibility of what they would like to see the insulation resistance test done for AM2 and AM2S
yep.
with a lighting circuit with more than one switch control and a lighting point. Is that
yeah.
true?
Yeah, so there'll be two slightly different methods that we look at. And again, we've got to bear in mind all the time, think about the circumstances that you're testing in. When you're testing in the real world, you'll carry out the testing to make sure the circuit is completely safe and that you're comfortable with that. But sometimes, perhaps in an exam situation, we need to do the test in the way that the examiner is expecting us to do it. So it's important just to bear that in mind moving forward.
So we'll look at that in the next video. So we're going to end this one, do you reckon?
Absolutely.
Okay. Yeah. We hope this video has been some help.